Let me start. Can you? Are you going to write somewhere, or will you just speak?
Yeah, we'll speak.
We'll speak. Okay. So let us begin with the basic things. Can you tell me about the activity life cycle?
Activity life cycle is on create, on start, on pause, on resume, on stop, on destroy.
Okay. So whenever there is a dialogue,
okay,
when the dialogue comes, so what are the life cycle methods that gets called? Can you just tell me?
Suppose one activity is there and you have click one button and one pop up came. Mm-hmm. The activity will goes in pause. The pause method will call.
Yes. Okay. So when you click on this dialogue, what happens?
It will go to resume and again it will start.
Okay. So what happens when there is a configuration change?
It will again from on start to again it will call whole life cycle.
Suppose it is like when it is already there in on start, right? On start, on resume, on pause, everything will be called, right?
Yeah.
So now it is on resume state. It is already in the active state. Okay. So now you change your landscape mode.
Okay.
Your orientation will change. On save instance.
On save instance, it will call. Mm-hmm. And it will call because in Android, this is the one of the drawback that like if you changing the rotation, it call whole life cycle again.
Yes. So what are the life cycles that get called after that? So in this on pause, it will not directly call on create, right? So it has some method. On save instance. So it will not stop on destroy and then on create. It doesn't call that? That's what I'm...
It will call on destroy because activity is already is destroyed and it's going to create new. So it will destroy. It will call to
destroy. So if it calls destroy, then what does it call next? On create, on start. Or does it call something else?
On save instance, on restore instance, it will also call in that.
On create will be called only once, right? Then on create view, which is a fragments thing. Then everything will be same as activities, right? On start, yeah. On resume and everything. Yes. So how do you create the layout?
We can create using the view. Okay, like we having so many layouts.
We have different components for UI, right? Which are the components? We can talk about first.
We can use view group, like in view group, like relative layout, linear layout, frame layout. Constraint layout is also there nowadays. So and then inside view group we have different views. Okay, like button, text, edit text, all those things.
Okay, so can you tell me why exactly we use relative layout? Why do we use relative layout and when do we use linear layout?
Actually, in the linear layout, we can attach the view horizontally and vertically. But in relative, if you are going to use a relative layout, then all the view will be in format of related. Everything is related to each other. So if you are doing to going to change in between some view, it will affect to all view.
Okay, then what about frame layout?
Frame layout, like you have seen Google map application. So if you want something like one view is there, then over the view you want something, then you need
to use overlay kind of a thing which you want on top of it.
Yes, absolutely.
Then what about this constraint layout, which is latest, right? Why exactly we use it? In constraint layout
we have lots of advantages. If you are going to use constraint layout, no need to use other layout like linear, relative, you can forget about that. So directly in that constraint we can attach all the view, and based on constraint, I mean all the layout, we can fix everything. So and
I'll tell you one thing.
One advantage is there, like we have different devices, right, in Android. That is one of the drawback of Pandora.
Yeah, that's the main reason why I asked you, because relative layout also does the same thing, right? Yes, yes. So that's the major thing because of which we use constraint layout.
Yes.
Yeah. So
you have worked on Kotlin as well, right?
Yes, yes.
Currently, so how do you feel working with Kotlin?
It is a very awesome. When I came to this company, previous company I have worked fully on Java, then I came to this company and I was started working for Fortis, then it was a fully on Java, so it was very difficult to, I mean, it was understandable because somebody has written the code. So again we have started one project that is OPDMR. So in that application, doctor can book appointment also, and like we are going to hospital. So there will be a list of the patient who has came to the hospital, and while clicking on next call, next button, it will goes to the main page, and in that there will be so many details, like doctor can fill all the disease and everything, he can fill that with the application. And if the patient comes again, all the whatever data he has filled first time, it will be, everything will be recorded on that, and that having lots of feature in the application. So we have developed from scratch, and from Kotlin navigation architecture, Jetpack libraries, all those things like data binding, these things.
I'll come to that.
Okay.
So in Kotlin, what is the difference between val? We use something called as val and var, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Why exactly? What is the difference between?
Val is something like value, and var is something like variable. So val, if you are going to use val, then that means final. You cannot change the value again. But in
it's a static.
Yeah, but in var you can change the value. Like if I assign something, later you can change something else.
Change it. Okay. What is the use of late init? We use something called as late init,
yes,
right? For some.
Yes.
Yeah.
Late init is like later initialization. You are going to assign some variable, but you have not initialized the variable. Later you are going to initialize the variable. So that is
now what happens, suppose if you have not initialized it,
okay,
and you run the code,
okay,
so there will be a problem of getting Kotlin null pointer exception, right?
Yeah.
Not initialized exception.
Yes.
So how do you overcome that exception?
Like we have this thing, Elvis operator. So we can use that, and
but Elvis operator also will not work in that case, because it is like we have something called as is initialized or something. Elvis operator will come when it has been initialized. You will give something right, question mark dot equals to null or something you'll put, right? In that case, it will be valid. But for this, we have something called as is initialized. This particular parameter, right? Late init field, it has something called as is initialized. If it is initialized, then only do something. Otherwise, don't do it. We do that thing.
Yeah, that also we can do, is initialized. But like you are passing some value from one fragment to other fragment by using bundle. So that time, if you are passing from A fragment to B, but sometime you are coming from C to B, that time you are not passing bundle thing. That time the bundle thing will be a null. So at that time we can check that by using this Elvis operator.
We can check that. But there will be possibilities where you might miss those things.
Yes.
And then in this case, that initialize, we will get that kind of exception called as Kotlin.
No, that initialization. If you use the Elvis operator, that time it won't call that. So there will be no, this exception will come. Because at that time you are using a Elvis operator, it will return from there only. So it won't go later.
Okay, because I had faced this issue. I'm not sure. Let us meet. Maybe.
Yes.
Yeah. What are the different launch modes? Have you worked on launch modes in Android? Like, there will be different launch modes,
yes,
right?
Yes.
In manifest report.
Yes. launch mode is standard, single instance, single instance, and my 3-4 is there. I'm getting forgot. Standard, then single instance.
What does standard do?
Standard is like if you have A, B, C, correct? You have launch mode is A, B, C. Okay, then you want to B call again. So the A, B, C will be not there, then A, C, B it will come.
Sorry, I didn't get you. Sorry.
Like we have launched activity. We have three activities A, B, C. Okay. Then in between you wanted to launch B activity. So that time it format will be get changed. A, C, then B.
So you're saying it will just bring it from the back to the top of.
Yeah, it will take.
That is what standard does. You're saying.
Yes.
What does single top does then?
Single top
what you said was for single top. What standard does is if it is already having A, B, C, it will not bring B back to front. It will create one more instance of B.
Okay, A, B,
A, B, C, B.
Yes.
So that it creates a new instance. Whereas single top, if it is already there in your task, it brings it to the front of the task.
Yes.
Stack. That's what it does. Then what about single instance?
Single instance.
Single task.
Single task, single instance. So in single task, it will be you have A, B, C. So first I said, I think that format it will follow.
Which format?
I told there will be three.
That was single top.
Okay, single top. So, and not sure.
Then you have worked on services, right?
Not much, but I have some ideas.
Okay. So you have not worked on that. Do you have hands-on experience in that?
No, I have. I mean, not in deeply. I have a broadcast receiver for internet purpose. Like internet is not there, so I need to check that.
Can you tell me about broadcast receivers? It will send the message
to the user. If something happen in the system, it will send the notification to the user, like internet is not there or battery is low. So it will say to the user
Have you worked on something like custom broadcast receivers or something?
In broadcast we can do different thing also, like you want to change data in between, so that time also we can use custom.
What are the methods which are there in broadcast receiver?
On receive.
So whenever there is something, we need to register this broadcast receivers if we want to get the events. So should we register it somewhere or should we do some procedure?
In manifest file, we need to register like activity we are doing. From there we can get.
We can do it locally as well, right? You need not do it in... If you're writing it in manifest, then you are exposing it to everybody, to the Android system.
If you want the broadcast thing to be there only locally, then you can do it locally as well, right? In your activity level. That I have not done, but yeah, maybe as possible.
Then have you worked on intent services or something? List.
Intent services. No, I have not worked much. Service part, not. I mean, in previous company, I have used the service. I'll tell you why I was using. In the movie application, one user has subscribed the movie application. But what happened? He has put the application today at 12 o'clock. His subscription going to be end. So what he did? He at that time he put the application in background. So again he started using the application. So that time API will not get call from the starting API. So that server will understand that he having already registered. So no need to subscribe again. So it will, his movie will continue working. So for that, my manager asked me to do something like, so what we have used, like if application is more than 2 hour in background, so we can relaunch. So for that we have used services and the time clock, the timer. So
okay. Timer, exactly where you're using timer. In timer, if in the service itself you're using timer.
No, like whenever we are we was using the application, so it will called up main activity. So we have written one separate class in that, all the method we have written, like all the timer, second and minute will get called. So it will start counting, and in that application on in main activity we have wrote one method in that, if it is time is more than 2 hour counted, so it will relaunch the application. So that time all the API will get call, and it will, he has to again subscribe.
See, there will be a case where your activity is killed, okay, but your service will still be running, right? Yes. So how does that timer come into picture? The timer is gone, right? How will we get the information about the service? That information is lost. How do we handle that? How did you handle that? If you have done that,
okay,
main activity, in that case, how did you handle that? Because user will not be in the same activity, right? He will be having different activities, or there may be a case where he kills the application.
No.
But service will still be running.
If as at the time he put the application on background, then only service will get activated, and the timer will start running. Once he will.
So you had put it in which the service call? Where did you put it? In on pause.
On pause and on stop. So when we have found out one method, while application go to background, we need to write something. Okay, so some code, some lines of code was there. So once application will goes to background, the code will get called in the application. It was not life cycle method. So in that on pause, we have checked that. Hello. Hello. Yeah.
My internet is like very bad. Okay. It's raining here.
Yeah. So nowadays everywhere same.
I forgot what I was asking. Android 8, it has certain restrictions on the background services, right? You cannot run the background service for more than 5 seconds or something.
Yes.
So what was the solution that Android came up with?
Just job scheduler. I think they have launched that job scheduler.
Was it job scheduler, or was it job scheduler will be for particular time itself, right? It will be like every 5 seconds it will be doing. Yeah. But your case will not be valid for this particular job scheduler or alarm manager. It will not be possible for your case, right?
Yeah.
You want your service to be running independently, like forever, until certain time.
Yes.
Right. So for that, this job scheduler and alarm manager will not work. So in that case, Android had given something like start foreground service, right?
Yeah.
So with foreground, you will get a notification on top saying the system notification, your app is running. So that was what Android came up with.
Okay. Actually, in that foreground, background, and one intent, I think, bind service is there.
Bind service is also there. That is a different thing which will always be connected to your service until your activity is there, and until you unbind it.
Okay.
Then why do we use intent filters? Any idea? Where do we use intent filters? If you have seen.
Yeah, actually, intent filter we have used in manifest file. So actually, we in previous company we had this thing, deep linking. So for using deep linking, what we was doing, we had our on the this thing.
Some links.
Yeah.
URLs,
yes,
right?
Yes. Yes. So URLs host name was there. So we was checking that in that manifest file by using this filters intent.
So other than that, you're saying we don't use intent filters?
No, we can use different purpose we can use. But in the...
Will the application work without intent filters?
Oh, yeah, of course it will work.
Are you sure?
Yes.
How will the application launch the activity without intent filters?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, in that we use.
So what are the other attributes in intent filters?
URL thing also there. One other thing also, it's not remember now, but
the category is also important, whether it is launcher or whether it is browsable, whether it is default, that is important. And without that it doesn't work.
Orientation will be also there, I guess.
Orientation also you can put, that is not there in intent filters,
it is in the activity
or application level. But what happens is if you didn't view, it will do the Android system's default. It will change the orientation.
Okay.
Right. Default it will take. Then have you worked on permissions?
Permission.
Yeah, obviously you have to work because nowadays, like from 6 and above, there's a runtime permission thing, right? For 5 it was okay, but for 6 and all things. So how do you check runtime permissions?
Runtime permission, like whatever permission we are giving, like nowadays Google's, I mean this SMS permission and all we have is too dangerous according to Google. Other permission like get that, I mean this thing.
How do you call, or create a statement for that, like activity dot something, or you don't remember 2D level, or you don't, maybe you forgot.
Like we have this thing on start result activity, so in that we'll check this thing and
that is the result thing, right? How do you request?
Requesting permission, we use activity. Then in that we can write message, and then it will. Permission thing we can also directly do here.
We have two types of runtime permissions. One is system related run permission, which we get, right? We will just call check self permission. If this permission is there, then we will not show it. Yes. If the permission is not there, then we will request for that permission, right? Correct. Certain code and some permission string name, right? And then we get the result in what? Similar. It is on activity result is something else which you will get from intent or something. We have something called as on permission result something is there.
Yeah.
Permission result something. Yeah. So in that you will get whether it has been granted or whether it is not
granted. Yeah.
So based on whether it is granted or not granted, and there is one more checkbox, right? Do not show again.
Yes.
So in that case, what should we do? So those things are also there inside this. We can check for certain conditions, right? If you want to show a different custom dialog, we can do it or not?
Yeah, we can do it. Because there is one, if user will click do not show again, so it will never show again. User has to again clear all the cache, then it will...
Is it valid for the user? User will understand whether he has to clear or not. For that, making an easy thing,
then we need to use this again, some pop-up thing.
How do you show the pop-up thing again? Because once you do no, then it will always say not granted, right?
Yes.
It will never come into that loop. There will be a different condition for that.
Yes.
How do you handle that?
For that, we can, I think, we'll get... because if user will not, granted, that time we'll get some flag from the code. So we'll check that flag whether user has granted or not.
That's what user has not granted, and also has clicked on that do not show again.
Okay.
So it will not come in that part. It will come in some other part. So there is something called a should override that permissions or not. Something that condition is there, that method is there.
Okay.
So in that method, you will check whether it was ticked or not.
Okay.
So that method gives you whether it was like do not show or not.
Okay.
So based on that, you can show a dialogue, custom dialogue or whatever dialogue you want.
Okay.
And based on that, you can kick him back to the settings screen.
Okay.
Because there you cannot again show okay or that, right? You have to take him to the settings
screen. Okay.
So that's how we do it. Can you explain about the
MVVM
architecture? MVVM. Yeah,
it's a model view, view model.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, view, whatever user can see, we'll put in that. And view model, it is a bridge to communicate between server and to the view, what we are showing to the user. So in view model, we can directly bind data to the view. Okay. So it's easy to compare to other this pattern, design pattern. So
what is the difference now whatever you said, it is like what is the difference between MVP and MVVM?
MVP I have not used, MVC I have used. So okay. In that we are getting data from server. So if we are using that MVC, in that model view and controller will be there. So there the controller will be the bridge between view and model.
It is an intermediate where you can the controller has information about the activity, about the view as well as about the model you're seeing, right?
Yeah. And in that,
what about view model? Does it have information about the view and model?
View model directly wind the data with view.
With view in the sense what? XML or is it the activity?
In XML we can wind, and activity also we can wind.
So without data binding, suppose if the data binding part is removed.
Okay.
So will the view model have information about the view or not?
Yeah, of course, it will be there.
How will it have? The main reason which we are using view model is that we want to separate. It is like loose coupling. We are not coupling it with the view. Okay. So whenever in future if you want to change the view, it will be independent of the view, whether it is activity, fragment, XML, whatever it is.
Okay.
The view model can be replaced. It can be used for any other view. So the view model will not have any information about the context.
Okay.
Where it is coming, but it gives the information using live data and using data binding.
Yeah.
Data binding said it is directly. Can you tell me about data binding exactly how you used?
Data binding, we can directly bind the all the data to the XML. No need to write anything like setting thing. Like one text view is there. So what we was doing previously, we was without data binding, we was setting text dot set all the data to the in text view, but right now we can directly bind the data in XML. So whatever changes will be happen in that text, it will directly reflect to the view.
And if you see in the data binding also, there is nowhere view is not having any information about the view, right?
Yeah.
View model is not having any information.
Yes.
Only the XML and the view has information about view model,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell me why manifest file is being used?
Actually, manifest file, every application we use manifest file because it is a, we can say that is an entrance of the application. Without manifest file, we cannot use the application in that, because most of the
who
time
can, who cannot use the application?
Android Studio, we cannot run the program.
Not Android Studio. If your APK is being installed without manifest file, will Android system know?
But we are launching the application by using that manifest file. So if application we are activity is not, launcher is not there, how we'll use the application? And if permission is not there, so again we'll not use the application.
Android system will not know what to call, what to use.
Yes.
It will not have that binding thing, right?
Yes.
That is the one place where everything, all the information required for the system is being given there.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
And what does an APK file consist of? What does it consist of? Like what all things it combines?
APK files like all the information of the code, manifest file and a version thing, everything it will combine to this if it is Java or Kotlin, doesn't matter, it will get into white code something, so machine understandable language, and it will bind in one package, so and then it will give the APK.
So you're saying it has Java or Kotlin code, it has manifest files. Only two files? Only two things? Or does it have anything else?
Yeah, we can use C++ also.
Language. Talking about that. Okay. Now Java inside. Java and that is the classes, right?
Yeah.
Objects and classes.
Like dot key is there.
Resources also it has, right?
Sorry?
You missed the resources.
Yeah, resources. Raw elements. Yes.
Yeah.
Without that, we cannot.
Yeah. And have you used what was I asking you before this?
This thing, APK.
APK, right? Okay, I'll remember. I just found something and I forgot.
Bundle. Right now we are using
bundle. Okay, can you tell me about intents? Like?
Intent. Like we want to start activity or broadcast receiver or service.
Yeah, just define what is the intent and different types of intents that we can use.
Explicit intent and implicit intent we use. In that explicit intent, like you have defined, if you have target, then we can use explicit intent. Like if you are
what does target mean?
Target means activity. You are defining the like one activity to.
Okay. If you know the package name, exact activity name. That's what you're saying.
Okay. And explicit, you don't have that.
Explicit is that.
Yeah, implicit you don't have.
So if you want other applications, now suppose we have certain actions, right? Like view.
Yeah.
Like if you want to view a picture or something, there is something called an action we can use, like you want to open PDF. So what is that? Is it an explicit or is it an implicit kind of intent?
It is a implicit intent, not explicit, because you don't have the target, exact target.
Now suppose there is a service and there is some logic happening. Okay, you have done some logic to get some data, you've stored it into DB or something.
Okay.
Now you want to put some value into the UI. You want to show it into a UI. So how do you show that value into UI from service to activity? The communication in
like,
service to activity.
Like you want to pass some data? We can use...
Not from activity to service, from service to activity. I want some data to be shown on the UI thread.
Okay, like you have written one service classes, and in that you have write one name. That name you want to the activity, right? For that we can use, put extra we can use, no?
How will you pass that value?
This question I remember, but I don't know right now. I forgot.
There are a lot of interfaces, we have observers, we have bus events, we have
We can use interface also we can use, but
there are a lot of options.
Yeah,
there are a lot of options. Actually, you could have told one option.
Yeah.
Do you know why switch is being used in switch cases? You know, right? From Java, switch.
Kotlin,
so,
when?
When? So what is the difference between this when and switch?
Is it much better than Java? Because in switch case, you can write only one condition, correct? Like there will be 0 to 10 condition is there. So in every condition, you can do only one thing. Like if it is 0, then you can use only one. You cannot write 0 and 2. Like you have.
Okay, so it's like one at a time.
Like you want to execute two condition in one at a time. Correct. If it is 0 or 1, you want to execute the code. So in Java, you can't do that. 0, if it is 0, only one condition it will be valid. You can execute, but in Kotlin it is not like that. Like if you want to 0, 2, 3, it will execute the same code.
Whereas in switch case, we have only one type of integers or only strings. Like all should be of similar type,
yes,
right?
Yeah. In the Kotlin is not there.
And also we can add some expressions, yeah. Statements. Yeah. All these things are possible with when.
Yeah. Yeah, and in Java we need to use break also.
If you didn't use break, then in the next case statements it is not required. It does not need break. Is Kotlin class open for extension by default? No, it's not open. So what should we do for that? For that, in this thing,
open keyword is the modifier is there, so we can use open because it's already final, so we cannot extend and all. So like if you are inheriting the classes, then we need to use open modifier.
And we also use pending intent. Do you know where exactly have you used pending intent somewhere in your application?
In the notification we use the pending intent because after some time it will send a notification. So
it's because if there is some other application, they will not have access to our context, right?
Yeah.
So pending intent, any application can open the notifications. That is the main reason why we use pending intent instead of an intent.
Okay.
So in your previous applications there were notifications. We had a notification like we was using Moinges third party library.
So in that, what we need to do, like you have watched some movie, and you watched movie, and then after that some calls came and you left that movie, forgot about the movie. So it will be in that add to watch list or in watch list. Your half movie will be in pending. So that information I was sending to the Moinges server. So it will take hold the information about the user, and then based on while we have one dashboard and we had lots of condition like user have watched and if it is add to watch list, everything there was such kind of condition, and based on the condition it will send the notification. So many time we are getting the notification like you was watching this movie, so please continue this movie. So such kind of, so we was using that third party library Moinges.
Okay. So I also saw your resume in that it was mentioned you have worked on video consultation, right? So video consultation for patients, doctor.
Currently we have used Tableau, and in that it is a third party library. So in we need to use their interface in the application, and we can we have some APIs, and based on that we can communicate, we can use that video conference.
So you have not worked on any bus events or observers, have you used LiveData?
Yeah, I have used. Currently in the current project we are using LiveData, but bus event I have not used. bus event also okay. same I mean it was also but
it uses the same observer pattern observer, itself
yeah like if you are rotating thing that it will update your views
Any exceptions that you particularly faced in Android, like particular to Android, like null pointer and all these are all related to Java, right?
Array out of bounds. That is also Java, right?
Anything that is specific to Android.
Android, ANR. But some nowadays won't come. Nowadays it won't come because phone.
If you are running a lot of processing and all, then it is taking longer time, then it happens.
Nowadays, most of the company, they'll ask memory leakage. Nowadays, it will never happen in any phone because we have too much
space. That will never happen.
So, did you have any image processing?
Maybe you might have, right? Processing doctors or patients' photos and all. So what library did you use for this to show bitmaps?
With retrofit, this thing. For uploading image, we had, for showing image, we are using Fresco or Drawi library.
In both the companies, you use the same or something else? Glide, Picasso also we can use.
But the Fresco is better than for Glide and that thing.
But Glide is again owned by Google, right?
Yeah.
Like. Anyways, third party whatever. Yeah. Then have you worked on dependency injection or something like Dagger, RxJava?
No, RxJava. Few knowledge I actually the one there was a small API that I have worked but I don't have much knowledge on dependent Dagger and this RxJava in current company instead of dependency injection we are using coroutines
that is also fine, if you don't have that then Kotlin already supports scopes and all, suspension. And, coroutines you used, then what about coroutines is within this for threading purpose, now we have some subscribers and how do we listen to those data changes, like using live data or how exactly?
Subscriber
from your view model, how do you using interfaces or
see right now we have interface also there like there is a one item is there and you want to delete the item so observer for that we are using interface and observer will understand that data has removed so it will change the UI.
Okay. I think we have done most of the questions which I had taken.
Okay, I can ask you about this thing. Do you know about this race condition that happens in Java? No idea.
Thread multi-threading concept, no idea. Then you might not be knowing about the deadlock condition as well. Deadlock condition is like it will go to infinite loop, it will never end, not infinite loop, it will depend, like we can take it, to be frank, it is infinite loop only, but how does it occur? Do you have example, like there is a signal, okay.
And there is a four side of road, so all the vehicles come together in one shot. So that time, neither this vehicle is moving, neither that vehicle, no one is moving. So it can move, right?
Like you have one resource. Your example is signal is kind of a resource.
Yeah.
And then these two passengers are kind of threats.
Yeah.
Right. And so you're saying that both require this resource, this one resource. And they're not able to move, you're saying, but that will not happen, that is not deadlock condition.
Deadlock it will never remove like you are dependent someone but that is not moving ahead and others
why is it not moving ahead because that is dependent on this particular yeah. it's like thread one has access to one resource
yes.
thread 2 has access of one more resource. Okay. Now it used this resource and it wants this access, this resource, and this wants this access of this resource. So it is like R1 wants R2, R2 wants R1. So they both are not removing that lock.
Like,
and that's why there is a deadlock.
Like in manufacturing companies, we can see that there are, while production happening, one thing is going ahead, other thing is coming. So the like one particular product is not moving ahead, how can other will come to there?